Jedis, as I present to you the agents of the industry. My young Sith Lords, they come in various shades and sizes. Some hold the microphones and some of them are behind the camera. Join me, young Jedi, as I prepare you for the power of the dark side. This is the Conspiracy Corner.
Welcome to Thought Crimes, everyone. And of course, today's conversation is the people, the entity that's pulling the strings behind Drizzy Drake.
Yes, of course. Again, this is your boy Prince Solomon.
And this is your girl Sincere.
Let's get right into it. Now, Drake, I would say, more so than any other rapper, he had a very odd run, when you say so yourself.
Absolutely. I mean, even going to the OVO sweatshop, you can see that almost any style that has been made popular by Drake hasn't come from him. You know, even when he's like, he does the part, baby girl, when I think about, he got that from Party Next Door. Or, you know, you also look at The Weeknd, who did most of the groundwork, most of the dope tracks with Take Care. The album before that one sucked, but his most dope material comes from other people, other dope artists, in this manufacturing type of way. It's very weird because one can say that Drake is the most artificial artist that we've had in a long time, who is part black. I'm saying this, you know, people might say, whoa, why would you say that? We know that there were white artists manufactured in this way, singing over songs by Little Richards, stealing other people's work to make them have a particular type of image. But this is the first time to this extent that you had someone of African blood be pushed in this way, and one has to ask why.
I will go one step even further. I agree with your assessment there, but I would go even one step further and say Drake is by far the most corporate of all rappers
ever in history.
In history. Think about this. Now, a lot of people, they joke about the writing. They joke about the goofiness, the perceived goofiness of his personality, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you have to ask yourself, how is it that he's been able to last, especially given the damaged condition of his persona, right? Because think about that. He comes in the game. He says he's the rapper, right? He's the best rapper, one of the illest rappers. Then what happens? You have songwriters that fall out of the closet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, for the average rapper, okay, let's just say hypothetically, the average full-blooded black rapper, or I'll even give you one, Eminem, right? If there were several writers that came out the closet with Eminem, right?
His career would be destroyed.
It would be over. That's interesting. That's why I said something else is going on with Drake.
All right, but to counter that, which I'm just countering it because this is what people say to that, though. Drake is not, they don't consider Drake hip-hop anymore. They just want to hear the hot lyrics. They don't care that it's manufactured.
Mm-hmm.
So for them, who cares? Because they're not going to put him as the best rapper anyway anymore.
Well, here's the problem with that. That's when you know you have the word of the people from a different type of people in hip-hop or rap.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just be real, all right? Hardcore urban black fans, they're going to look at that and they're going to say, that's a little strange there, right? A lot of them for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
Average do-gooder kid partying in the Hamptons, it's a song to them. It's a hot song, whether it's Flo Rida, whether it's Biggie Hypnotized, that's all they know, or if it's Drake. Now, what was interesting, what took place with Drake, you had to give it to the entity that is behind Drake. Because once those allegations, and not only allegations, once those tales came out of the closet, they immediately shifted him to just being strictly a pop artist.
Well, not only that, but what they did was very slick. This is why Meek Mill, made a wrong move. Even though they said, we're gonna transition him to pop, they also gave him credit for back to back. Like, people forget that a lot of people who didn't like him, especially because he was about to get a big wave of hate, actually, even though people consider him a little bit popish, they're like, this is about to be a major backlash.
Yes, it is.
But when Meek Mill came out yapping and Drake put out the first diss, and people were like, it's okay, nice single, but and then a couple of days later, he put out back to back, it was over. People who didn't like him, the wave of negativity that was about to hit him, people started caping for him after Back to Back because of the strategic moves that was in the song, and also all the things that took place behind the song.
You know how I looked at Back to Back? Let me say this.
And I'm just gonna say before you say that, it was planned. It was so organized.
And this is what I wanna say here. Back to Back, for the track, what it was a good track. I disagree with some people. It's because I'm judging it by hip hop standards when we're talking about Ether, Hit 'Em Up, or No Vaseline, right? Or even what Roxanne Shantae did, right?
Yeah, Roxanne, that was really dope. That was hot.
That was a hard diss.
That's a hard diss.
Okay, what I saw Back to Back, it was a PR campaign move.
Exactly.
Everything with Drake. This is why I say Drake is a corporation.
He is.
Because think about this. Meek Mill presented some information that was critical and damaging, right? Let's be real. Back to Back, Drake can no longer claim credit for because of these information as far as the allegations surrounding his writing capabilities, right? Not saying the boy can't write, but now...
We're saying most of the dopest stuff that people
now
like.
Now everything has a question above it. Everything.
Yeah.
Everything. Sure. Even going back to So Far Gone. We don't really know what or who wrote that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what they were immediately doing, the people that were behind him, right? What they were immediately doing, they saw it. They said, okay, whoa. This is damaging to our product. We need somebody on this immediately. So whoever wrote Back to Back, because you think about it, it came too quick and they got it where it's to protect his image. So Drake can continue to move forward. Again, you joking, but I don't think you all are really looking at Drake for what he really is. And out of any rapper, he's had more strings pulled for him. Think about that. 50 Cent went diamond on his first album. He still didn't get a chance to have the strings pulled like this, although he could have, but his mouth did get him in a lot of trouble. But the way Drake was able to slide by with these allegations, if that would have happened to 50 Cent, I don't think there's no way impossible in hell that 50 Cent would have been allowed to continue on at that rate and speed. If anything, Drake almost in a sense got bigger after the allegations.
Well, we're gonna put it out there, but the people that are running Drake's finances aren't black.
Let's be real. Just say it. His producer, main producer, not black.
Yeah, 40, not black. We'll just say that, you know, his circle, his inner circle, his two best friends, the people who he really talked to, are not black.
Well,
now, his second tier friends and the ones who also, the second tier friends and the ones who are part of the sweatshop, all of those guys are black. But the main people in his inner circle, the ones who know the secrets, and the people who are also manufacturing him outside of Cash Money, they're not black.
Well, I like what you said there. And let's go ahead and illustrate this again for the people in case you missed it. Drake's inner circle, his close inner circle, his best friend that he considers his homies, Jewish Italian lineage, right? You have two cultures, basically, two different cultures that for the most part look at the black energy as just that, a stepping stone in society. What's interesting though, like you said, all of his songwriters are black. All of his artists that he milk for their style and talent are what?
Black.
Now, if you pay attention to that, and then you really look at what's taking place, let's go back here into history, right? We want to do that in hip hop. Can we do that here?
Yeah, we can.
Let's go ahead and talk about this, right? How did we arrive at a Drake? Think about this. When hip-hop hit the scene, right, Chuck D called it what? He called it the people CNN, the ghetto CNN, right?
Say
this is CNN for the hood, for the most part.
Absolutely.
The corporations saw hip-hop in its purest form, and they realized how powerful it was, especially during the Rodney King beatings, right? And they saw they had teenagers, college students, they had grown people cutting up in the streets. They were trying to figure out what was the reason for this. It was the music. It's the music. His music is too Afrocentric. It's too, has too much energy, too much cultural pride. Those were stated documents. Too much cultural pride in the music. So You started seeing them trying to sweep it the first couple times. You had the Beastie Boys, but all they wanted to do was drink and party, right? Then you have Vanilla Ice.
Mm-hmm.
Vanilla Ice almost had it. Almost, but he messed it up. He was too goofy. Couldn't continue.
Too goofy, and they made a mistake of fabricating his origin story.
Now, here's the thing, though. This tells you how critical and how successful the campaign in with breaking down hip-hop that they were able to do so. When the writing allegations came out with Vanilla Ice, it was damaging for his career. It did damage. It did big damage. Plus, some of the goofy moves he made with acting in movies and stuff. One could say Drake has a little bit more edge, but in a sense, in many ways, he's just as goofy as Vanilla Ice.
Well, before we go there, let's continue the story.
Yes.
Marky Mark.
Right. Now, they had Marky Mark. This is with Jimmy Iovine. Jimmy Iovine was trying to get it going with Marky Mark because, again, the whole goal was to just at least take the black face of the MC, whether that man or woman, off of hip-hop.
Now, Marky Mark had the street edge from Boston. He also was in gangs and different things and did a lot of bad things, but his music wasn't hard enough. It just wasn't authentic enough.
It was goofy.
It was still too goofy.
He looked like a Calvin Klein model trying to rap.
Exactly.
Okay?
Which he eventually was doing that.
Right. That's why he fell into the acting again.
Mm-hmm.
You had to ask yourself, was he acting the whole time? Okay? So what we're going to say here now, moving forward, though.
Eminem.
Now, here's the thing. Eminem was the biggest success.
The biggest rapper who was white ever.
Think about that. Now, they were able to successfully find something else outside of a black MC. Again, man or woman to represent hip-hop, which psychologically prepared the fans for something else to come.
But the thing that didn't work is Eminem wasn't, he didn't want to be corporate like that. Because of his personality and him also wanting to go back to being a private person, whatever they wanted to do with him, they couldn't.
Let's be real about that. Now, Eminem, I will say this, compared to some of the other non-black rappers that have come into the game, Eminem is by far one of the only ones that actually still shows love for the black legends.
Yes.
He does pay respects to the Queen Latifahs, to the Tupacs, to the Biggies, to the Nas's.
DMX's.
He even talked about it in his raps. He never really wanted the crown like that. He just wanted to be a part of the culture.
Which he is now.
Exactly. He's legacy cemented into the culture, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what was interesting, though, Eminem had a breakdown because of the drugs and everything.
Absolutely.
And then there was a route, it looked like they were trying to get him to pivot in, that he didn't want to go.
Exactly.
You can tell he talked about it in his music, even on Recovery. Even though people didn't like Relapse, if people listened to the album, he had a lot of messages in it. Now, moving forward, here we go. Just like with the President of the United States, it's interesting, though. We're going to tie this together. Interesting that Drake's reign began right when Barack Obama's presidency began.
Because absolutely. They both are Trojan horses.
Now, the establishment said, look, on both ends, we're talking about politics and music, but we're not really connecting to, but they're connected in a way, indirectly. Politics, they said, with Barack Obama, we need to get back into Africa. We need to launch AFRICOM. We can't do it under a white face because it'd be too damn obvious. They did it successfully under Barack Obama. Now, people don't know that Barack Obama's cousin, I believe it's his cousin or brother.
His half-brother.
He was a focal point in AFRICOM. Okay, a lot of people didn't know that, and they still don't. But you do your research, he has blood that is tied to AFRICOM.
Okay, so correction, his cousin is with AFRICOM. His half-brother was the one who was denouncing Barack Obama.
Yes, but his cousin was over AFRICOM. Now, here's the thing, though. With Barack Obama, they had to get a brown face to basically quell some of the anger.
A lot of the other countries.
Recolonize.
Like Drake is trying to do.
Reinstate the ties with Cuba,
mm-hmm,
as well. They had to get a brown face to, America seems like they progress. Now, going into Drake, though, remember there was the running rumor that Drake was Barack Obama's son,
mm-hmm,
right? They put that out there, making sure that they were tying Drake to that fanatical energy that people felt with Barack Obama. And it was this running thing in hip-hop. So part of them colonizing completely with hip-hop, they had to get somebody with a little bit of black in their blood.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just enough, right? But people forget, initially Drake didn't, there was a resistance at first.
Yes, well, a couple of times actually. Yes. A couple of times black people had resisted Drake. But with the campaign he had, and also with the youthful idiots like Cash Money, Lil Wayne, and Baby, and also the people pulling strings behind him, he was able to readjust every single L he's ever taken in his career.
We're going
to
get into that.
Whether rapping on a blueberry, be it
Blackberry. You said a blueberry, yeah.
Blackberry, mm-hmm. Whether getting pissed on, whether the writing, not even allegations, facts.
Yes.
With people, the source material has already came out there. The Weeknd, Party Next Door. From everything, it's already known that those are facts. And also, Drake being corporate, you know, he's also an actor. People forget he's an actor. So he pretends. He pretends to like people. He pretends that he has a backstory to liking a product. Oh, the Panthers are my favorite because in 19, blah, 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 I wore them. This is what he does. He's a liar, actually. He's a pathological liar when it comes to the art of marketing. Which I guess one could say marketing to an extent is about lying, but it's also about finding some type of truth within that lie to connect to people. Because you can't connect something that's artificial unless you have a backstory behind it.
Exactly. And now what they were able to do, though, they had to get that Cash Money sign, that Young Money sign, right? So remember, Lil Wayne was at the height of his career too, as well.
Yes, 2008 is when he was just coming off of,
yeah, just coming off the high of Carter 3, you know, still making certain moves, right? Then, so what they were trying to do, they was kicking it out there in the rumor mill. Remember at the beginning of Drake's career that Drake was ghostwriting for Wayne. Remember that?
Yes.
When Wayne had all of those dope punchlines, regardless of how y'all feel about Wayne, there was a period at one time Wayne was on everybody's list.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? All of those dope punchlines. They was like, yo, so Drake, blah, 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 is writing for Wayne. So then now people are looking at Drake like, oh, so he must be a cold little lyricist.
Yeah, basically solidifying him, you know, also with his verses on, you know, Rick Ross joints, even collaborating with Meek Mill before their fallout. They put a lot of pro-Drake rumors out there.
Propaganda.
So a lot of black people who were really into hip-hop who thought he was whack, to be honest with you, those rumors did solidify him for them as well. They'd be like, I don't like certain albums of his, or I don't like certain songs, or I don't like the way he look, or I don't like him to that. But, you know, he writes his own stuff. Well, he can't get mad at that. And some of his verses I like.
They did two things at the beginning of his career to definitely place him into the circles of being
accepted,
legitimized too as well. Mm-hmm. They did the ghostwriting rumors for Wayne. Then they were always standing him next to J. Cole at the beginning of his career. J. Cole was already seen as a cold ass lyricist.
Exactly.
He was not seen in the same light as Drake.
I also want to put out, even though he's half black, J. Cole did not have any of the issues Drake had when it came to being accepted by the culture. Also, he didn't have the puppets that are pulling Drake strings behind him, because his mother is not Italian Jew, she's just a regular white chick from the United States. So, and then also J. Cole, you know, just from the very beginning of his career, just said, I'm black and I'm proud to be that, you know, even
which
though,
something Drake has never done.
Exactly, even though my mom is white. So, partnering Drake up with that energy, it didn't just make it seem like Drake had that type of
mindset.
Yeah,
what they did, they gave them, earlier in the career, they gave them a Nas and Jay duality, a Pac and Big duality.
Mm-hmm.
So now, every time J. Cole was brought up, guess who else was brought up?
Drake.
This is the art of the hustle. So we're just playing in this as we're moving along, because a lot of people, they look at Drake and they don't really pay attention to what has actually taken place, that is.
Mm-hmm.
So now we had, he came off the high, what was it, the So Far Gone album, right?
Mixtape,
right? Which now, to be honest with you, we don't know who wrote that. We don't know if or what level or how much he wrote when it came to that album.
When you look at the mixtape, he had a lot of great features on there.
Style has changed too.
Trey Songz, Lil Wayne. I mean, this is a mixtape. You already have, you know, a lot of people who are already in the industry on this mixtape.
Exactly. Now, this was supposed to be his jump start.
Now, one can say he had his original tracks. Things probably got remixed in the studio,
mm-hmm.
you know, to get co-signed. One could say that, but because of what we've seen, and Drake is a culture vulture, don't make any mistake about it. Everyone who's upset that has been true. But despite that, we still don't know.
Now, the real question does arise, because with the success of So Far Gone, it was critically acclaimed. People were feeling it all over the country. They was like, oh yeah, that is the jam. What happened between So Far Gone and Thank Me Later?
Thank Me Later was, it's a complete ass album. And then when you look at Take Care, that's when he went to his sweatshop. He got The Weeknd, took most of his jams. He had a lot of writers on staff for him. And then you look at Nothing Was the Same. Party Next Door wrote a lot of those singles. That sound, his rapping pattern and flow, it comes from that R&B singer. That's why a lot of R&B people who aren't famous, it resonated with them. Like if you go on YouTube, a lot of people who were just regular YouTube people who are musically inclined were remixing those songs because it spoke to them, because it had an R&B glitch to them. But again, Party Next Door, The Weeknd, and then those made his albums more hot. Whether you don't like half of the album of Take Care, whether you don't like certain songs on Nothing Was the Same, everyone has to admit that they were far, far better than Thank Me Later, and that was due to his sweatshop people.
Also, you can take a joint like Practice, which clearly has The Weeknd's fingerprints all over it. He's known for taking hip-hop joints and flipping them like that.
Yes.
Okay, now, whatever the case was, because it was strange at the time, J. Cole and Drake both, as far as the critical masses is concerned, they both bombed with their debut. However, J. Cole's stuff was explainable. He said, this was the corporation, this is the route they wanted me to go, I wasn't feeling it.
And he took advice from other people.
Nas.
And that's why he retracted on that, you know. Also, Nas being one of the big people said, yo, why did you did the album? It was whack. You know, then he made that song. When he made Born Sinner, he explained all that in that album, why that happened, him getting over his ego, and making sure him and Nas basically rekindled that friendship. And just a lot of other things that took place. And then, you know, J. Cole made his own beats also for Born Sinner. You see him in the process, it's evidence. And then he goes in to make his classic hip-hop album,
Forest Hill. Yeah.
So he's already solidified himself in the pages of hip-hop and rap history. Meanwhile, Drake still hasn't had a classic hip-hop album. And on top of that, One Dance, Hotline Bling, all his most popular songs come from people from the UK, people from Canada in his sweatshop, and people that he lures around in the United States who are underground producers or hip-hop artists. Let's be real.
Let's go back to it now. Thank Me Later bombed critically, all right? It sold well, but critically, people say, what was up with that? Now, you have to ask yourself, again, if you paid attention, was it that Drake avoided L's because he was somehow just a genius mastermind? You have to think about the strings being pulled behind the scenes.
They were always cleaned up for him.
There you go. Cleaned up. They were always protecting him. So Thank Me Later hits, it was a dud. People were like, oh, that was whack. So they immediately grouped the quote-unquote OVO sweatshop. They get the best songwriters, the best singers, the best lead vocalists. These people to stand behind Drake. This was interesting. Again, Drake was being marketed as a rapper with R&B croonish tendencies. Wasn't a rapper singer, just R&B croonish tendencies. The Weeknd is a singer. Okay? Party Next Door is a singer. Drake is a rapper with R&B croonish tendencies.
And also, the reason why I worked for him, because The Weeknd and Party Next Door, they're singers, but they add hip-hop elements.
Exactly.
And there's certain cadences within their rhythmic singing, or things where they just be like, ah-da-da-da, that Drake took and he made it his entire style. Now, of course, The Weeknd said, hey, I'm not going to be a part of the sweatshop anymore. You took a lot of the songs that I was going to use. It's cool. I'm a genius. I'm going to come up with other shit anyway. See you later. Sayonara. Right? So he goes off and become a major solo act. Now, You have Party Next Door, though, who is sick and tired. He looks like he's tired of playing the background. You have Drake going around the circuit talking about work, 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 work. You know, saying how, yeah, it's a good track. Gave it to Rihanna. Where's the mention of Party Next Door? He's the one who's he wrote that track. Now, yeah. What he did is, this is where 40 comes in. Mm. This is why 40 is very important. So if The Weeknd, when he used to work with Drake, or if we fast forward to Party Next Door, what he would do is, if they have he would just change the tempo. So work, 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 work for Party Next Door, where he wrote, he said it was supposed to actually be a slow jam about being tired of working, wanting to go home, be with somebody you love, this and that. So what people like 40 or other producers in Drake's sweatshop do is they just flip it for him.
Yes, that's what they do. Now, let's go back to Eminem for a minute. Mm-hmm. Eminem, regardless of how people felt initially about him, okay, he still conceded to the culture. He didn't do what Drake is trying to do, which is trying to completely vulturize the culture, dominate the culture.
He steals people's styles.
Right.
Completely.
Yes, Eminem didn't. Mm-hmm. Okay, the only thing that can even get close to him is, you know, with proof. But they're friends, assisting
they're
each
friends,
other.
And the only thing they can get him with is when he started out, he kind of sounded a little bit like a New Jersey rapper.
Right,
But still,
slightly,
he wrote his own rhymes.
Yeah, but still, he embellishing his background, which all the rappers do.
Yes,
all musicians.
Everybody.
Do.
50 Cent does
anybody
that.
In the showbiz, yeah. Embellish their background, right? It's
to make them, you know, an
bigger.
Icon.
Yes, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
But he got out of the way for the most part. He got out of the way. He had to go do his rehab thing. But he conceded to the culture. He never tried to take anybody and everybody's style. You know, Royce da 5'9".
He created his own.
Yeah, and even the fact that he gave Royce da 5'9" his props.
Mm-hmm.
Drake has not. You know, if Drake had a Royce da 5'9", he would destroy him out of fear of him being perceived better than him.
Exactly.
Eminem didn't. He embraced him. In fact, what he did, he went back and got the Slaughterhouse Camp to put them on as well.
Now, people will say, though, oh, he praised DMX, he's praised Eminem, he's praised, eventually he came out and praised Kendrick, eventually, you know, he praised J. Cole. What you people have to understand is he praises people who have the
ability
to destroy him.
Exactly. Exactly.
Meek Mill elevated him. That's what Meek Mill dumbass did.
Yeah, that's what was sad about it. Here's the thing. Now, we're going to go to Meek Mill.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say this. The industry got on Meek Mill for several different reasons. And people, you know, they tend to get stuck behind the memes. How about this? Sincere, right now. Can you name a dope, famous street rapper at this point in time? Not trapping.
I would say real quick, the only one who has the opportunity to bubble up, but they have more, they do have a lot of bags that they need to see through is Herb and Montana of 300. But I can't name anyone
that has
that much buzz.
Now. This is the energy Meek Mill originally represented.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why the industry shut him out, too, as well.
Part of the industry. There's the other part that was actually...
Embracing
him.
Now, that part, we're going
to
talk about that part. That part of the industry that was embracing Meek Mill, those were the classic hip-hop heads and even the younger guys that wanted to see that energy back in hip-hop. They wanted to see the Beans.
Jay-Z,
they wanted to see the Jada Kiss.
Switch Beats.
In fact, that's why Jay-Z got behind him. Meek Mill represented... the traditional streetwise rapper, the streetwise griot, right? The poet, right? So his energy coming in to usurp, not necessarily on a large level, but for the most part, destabilize some of that Drake-ish energy we got going on. Because think about it, under the Drake reign, right? Whoever's reigning in rap music and hip hop, you will see the underlings mimic to a degree. So Drake is not perceived as a street dude, right? So under all of this Drake crooning energy, even on the street level, the thugs or the street guys are sounding like Young Thugger. They sounding like Uzi Vert. They're all harmonizing. They all have this weird crooning energy.
But badly. I want to also clarify, we're not talking about the crooning that Kendrick Lamar does.
No.
We're not talking about even Tory Lanez.
People or who Nate Dogg.
Well, we're not even talking about New Jack Swing. We know there are people who could do it well. We're talking about the degenerates. Go ahead.
Right. So we have these guys that that weird.
Also, you know, Vic Mensa or Chance the Rapper. Those are the people who do it well.
Not classified as street rappers, though. They don't talk about Merkin. They don't talk about.
No, that's what I'm saying. Vic Mensa, they are part of the singing rapper, but they do it well.
Those guys, Vic Mensa and Chance the Rapper, they're caught in the space between Kendrick and Kanye.
Yes.
That's where they are.
Yes.
We're talking about guys that are specifically talking street.
Mm-hmm.
So even on the street rapper edge, they're singing or they're crooning or they're sounding a bit Drake-ish. Meek Mill was not a part of that. He was completely, strictly bars.
Mm-hmm.
All day, every day. This is why it was dumb and unfortunate, the move he made.
He made one of the dumbest moves in hip-hop history, and if you knew the backstory to it, you would know why.
Right. So, when Meek Mill did what he did, right, the fans, for the most part, they were like, oh, okay, that's what's up. This is how powerful his move. Even now, despite what had taken place with Drake, people always come back to the music. Because after everybody got it out of their system, ha, 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 Meek Mill, blah, 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 they called him all these names, right? People went back and still listened to his album.
Look, that was a classic album.
Yes, his album was a classic album. It was a classic street album.
Number one.
Yes.
It was still climbing until it got eclipsed with the Drake beef.
Exactly. But now people still go listen to it and they're like, yo, that was a knocking album. This is why Meek Mill was right on the cusp of bringing that classic street energy
basically
back to hip-hop.
Basically going the Jay-Z route.
Well, yeah, I mean, even if we want to go talk about Nas, right? This Nas is older right now.
And we're not saying
that
he's the same level as them. We're just talking about the atmosphere, being in that spectrum.
Energy. They know what I'm talking about. Those people that immediately be like, oh, he ain't better than that. You are a Drake stan from the jump, so you don't want to look at it beyond that. So what we're saying here, Drake did pay attention to all of that because you got to look at what was falling behind Meek Mill. You had Meek Mill kicking the door back in for street rappers, for the new generation. You had G Herbo behind him. You see what I'm saying? You had all of these other cats that are in line to bring that street energy back. So Drake immediately, or the people behind him, said, hey, we want to maintain your dominancy in hip-hop. Here's a track back to back. And the way he flipped it, too. Now, you got to understand, maybe this was a calculated move in a sense, because how the story starts, of course, it's about Nicki Minaj. She's in the middle of it. Meek Mill supposedly thinks that Drake is talking about him when he says the girl of your dreams. Now, we don't know if that's almost like a false flag to get rid of that street energy, because he probably figured Meek would go in that direction.
Well, and because, let's be real, like Rico, it wasn't even, most of it was written by Quentin. Now, what Drake did, though, is he did add some differences in the
usual Drake-ish stuff.
Tweaked it a bit. And we're not saying that Quentin is something special when it comes to charisma. We know that he's behind the scenes person. He can never be an in front person. He just doesn't have that charisma to be so. But he's a great behind the scenes person. And what he did was he laid that verse down for Drake, as he did with a lot of the songs for the album that most hip hop people like.
Exactly. Now, I know when I listen to If You're Reading This, It's Too Late, I was like, oh wow, something's different here. Now people, even some of the folks in the mainstream media, after If You're Reading This, It Was Too Late, Then It's Too Late, people were expecting something like that on the next album, Views From The Six, right? Remember the big hype behind it.
Mm-hmm.
But after those scandals and things came out of the closet, Drake had to get rid of everybody.
He cleaned house. Probably was going to go back in that direction anyway. But he probably would have mixed it up more.
I don't think he was going to go in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
I think what he went with was what he knew worked best.
Mm-hmm.
At that last minute. That's why he held that grudge against Meek. Because
yes,
Drake was going
to... Yes, he did say in his song that there's some niggas that I will never forgive. And right. Meek is on that list.
Right. Because Drake was going to take it in a different direction, as you saw hints of, because that they did something weird. If you're reading this, it was an album, but they classified it as a mixtape. But then when it sold well, it was an album again.
Mm-hmm.
So he was experimenting. So he saw tracks like Energy worked. or Young Nigga Preach.
All of them.
Everything worked. Madonna, all of those tracks worked, right? So he was like, all right, so I found this concoction here with my new sweatshop members of mixing in street trappish UK sound with classic R&B beats. And then my lyrics are a little edgier now, right? And then I'm working with edgier cats. So this is the energy he was going to go with on Views from the Six. But when Meek jumped in and dropped that out there, he had to clean shop because now he was like trying to figure out who snitched on him. Because remember, the whole point of it was a reference track got leaked.
Reference tracks.
Yeah.
Oh, a lot of them, absolutely.
So when that got leaked, now Drake being suspect and who he is, he can't trust anybody, right? That's his whole thing. He can't
except
trust
except for 40,
anybody.
Yeah.
Right. Well, any of these people within this black urban industry, you know. Anybody,
which he has a resentment for a lot.
Yeah, anybody outside of his Jewish-Italian connection, right? So, now he had to rely on what he knew best, which was Views from the Six, which was that classic pop-ish, almost Thank Me Later.
Which is still not his stuff.
But he went back to his old cats, right? That's why people had such a violent reaction to it critically, right? But it's so based under the auspice and the illusion that it was going to sound something like...
Well, of course, with the name, Views from the Six, you think it's going to be a Toronto hip-hop record.
Also, it was so because people thought it was going to sound like If You're Reading This, It's Too Late, which it ended up not sounding like. So at this stage right now, Drake is in, he's in reactive mode, right? So think about this. He's getting all of this energy, this backlash is kind of building, surrounding him, who he is. You saw the thing with Joe Budden, right? Couldn't really finesse it properly. He couldn't really put Joe Budden on ice. So he had to concede to another guy, right? And then so now he's at the point where he has to see where he's going to go with it. But what was able to happen in that entire process, here you have an individual, think about it, coming out of a whole country, refuses to put anybody else on. You have to think about it. That's pretty powerful. That's different than somebody coming from the state. They say, oh, they from Texas or they from New York and they're not trying to put nobody else on. 50 Cent was fighting with other rappers in New York, right? But they were still able to come out and eat. Drake, behind the scenes, was politically blackballing people in
the music
industry.
Yes, that's why he has a strong relationship with a lot of the Canadian politicians. That's why he tried to blackball certain people from coming to the country and perform, like Chris Brown, for example, who I don't like. But he's one, or he was also some buzz when he first started getting into issues with Jay-Z that he tried to do the same thing with Beyonce, but that didn't work because Beyonce's Beyonce. He's tried a lot of underhand things. Some that has worked, some that hasn't. But, yes.
Yeah, and this is why, out of all of the rappers that irritate him the most, Jay-Z does.
Yes.
He wants what Jay-Z has. He wants to be Jay-Z.
If you go back some years ago, about 3 years ago or so, when he was doing an interview, I think it was Angela Martinez, he said, I want what Jay-Z has. I want a Beyonce, someone who's career oriented as me, who can be on my arm, we can go to these events together, and I know she will have my back no matter what. That's what he said.
Yeah, and there's actually a real power struggle behind the scenes. That's why he was saying he's the new Hove, and then Jay-Z's like, you're not the real Hove.
You're not me. Yeah.
You're not me. So Drake, he would like to do what he's done with guys like Party Next Door. Well, he liked to apply that same measure and tactics to a Jay-Z.
Who he's insanely jealous of.
Right, but he hasn't been able to flex his muscles properly. Now, what he's doing, though, he does focus on guys like Tory Lanez. Tory Lanez is a big thorn in the side because he's insanely talented.
Yeah, he can write his own lyrics. He comes off with his own riffs. He's an actual singer/rapper. He doesn't need a sweatshop.
Right, and he's from, Toronto.
And to be frank with you, Drake would have wanted someone like that in his sweatshop. I mean, how that brownstone was swept.
Think about that. That would have been perfect for the energy he was going to go after if you're reading this, it's too late.
No, oh yeah, if he went with that type of energy
and got Tory Lanez as a ghostwriter, all of a sudden, too. Yes, and then people would have, you know, heard his bars would have sounded a lot harder.
Mm-hmm.
Tory Lanez is insanely talented.
He is.
It's ridiculous. So there's nothing Drake could really do at this point regarding Tory Lanez except for keep trying to have his name associated with Tory Lanez' movement. That's another thing Drake has been able to successfully do. Anytime somebody's movement is kicking, he would align himself with it. Remember
Gucci Mane when he first came out?
Yeah.
Bobby Smurder until he went to prison.
Well, let's go back to Future. Future had the biggest album of his career, Dirty Sprite.
He hooks, he puts his tentacles on Future
to get some of that energy.
Yeah.
And then he was able to slide Metro Boomin to get him on some of his work.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So
Kanye West.
Exactly.
Anyone you could think of that was hot at any time.
Yeah, so now what he's trying to do, because let's be real, the music thing, Drake, where you we got like an album or two left in him.
Probably so.
Albeit if the resistance doesn't get any stronger, how people are feeling about him at this point, right?
Mm-hmm.
So now he's making his moves after hip hop, which is Rihanna, whose worth, what, 240 million?
Yeah, 240 or 250 million. No, 240 million.
Right. So now he's looking for the longevity route.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, pay attention though. What we're saying here, the shark tattoo, real quick. Yeah, they both got shark tattoos.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. The entire time Drake has been in the industry, time after time, things have been cleaned up for him.
That, and I also want to go back to one thing with Rihanna, something we talked about before. Chris Brown and Rihanna could have easily been a $1 billion couple. You know, being in the pop world, being able to sell the way that they did.
And as young as they were
when they got together, they could have easily became a $1 billion couple. And then all the endorsement Chris Brown was getting prior to the domestic violence and his antics afterwards, it definitely damaged that. But that's something that, you know, of course, someone like Drake looked at it as a gift for himself because he'll try to make that work in that type of way for himself.
Exactly. So if you paid attention to it, think about it, what they were able to do is something that they tried with Millie Vanilli. Not Millie Vanilli. Wait a minute. Well, Millie Vanilli was, they were puppets in
the day. Well, low level. Yeah, they weren't trying to take over the whole music industry.
They were just trying to be vain. Yeah.
And the sad thing is one of them actually did. Actually, both of them could sing, but they still had other people lay down the tracks.
Their music,
this was very awkward.
The industry wasn't ready for their music at the time.
Yeah.
Which they could have easily pulled off today.
Yes.
But what the industry was trying to do with Vanilla Ice, excuse me.
Yes.
They have been able to successfully do with Drake. And look, this isn't about battling about the golden age of hip hop or what's real lyrics. It's about what's real and what's not. You have to go through the entire catalog now. If you think about it, study it. Drake is the most corporate. Now that he has been able to establish himself on his own, and you know, they ask him, would you reunite with Baby and Wayne? He pretty much says, no, we'll come to an understanding. I hope everything works out with them too. I've moved on.
He's moved on, although he sided with Lil Wayne because it'll make him look better by doing that.
And then he can disassociate himself from Baby too.
Exactly.
That was the point, is disconnecting from Baby so he can move on freely.
Mm-hmm. And also Baby is another pawn and a dumbass. You know him, he's going to be broke soon.
Oh, all those lawsuits that are pending on him.
Yeah.
So now the lawsuits are going to hit him now that Drake is no longer directly up under the camp in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Now they say, okay, let the house fall. We got our man out.
Mm-hmm.
So everything, if you study from him coming into the game and his inception initially being linked with Barack Obama during that whole fanaticism, and everybody was kicking those rumors out for him, people claiming he was writing for Wayne to give him some validation, being associated with J. Cole, and then
associated with Kendrick Lamar.
Yes, he was, and then also he was terrified of Kendrick Lamar. And Kendrick Lamar was dropping out there, sharing the bars.
Let's be
like
real.
A two-man sale.
Kendrick Lamar was not as scared of Drake.
No, he had no reason.
It's other reasons of mediators who just thought that Drake was real, and they just like, I don't want to see two guys beefing, that squashed that. But Kendrick was gonna tear him a new one.
Oh yeah, Kendrick wasn't scared. He's got the cats in his
the heart of hip hop.
Yes,
you know,
does.
He's mainstream in his own way. He's not, but he's not corporate. But he's mainstream in his own way, and he can reach the same amount of people that Drake can.
Yeah, Drake.
And be critically acclaimed.
The thing about Drake is that it's in the front, right? But people fail to realize how much Kendrick's influence is actually stronger than Drake's.
Yeah.
Because Kendrick, from the new cats that are coming out that are this edgier conscious style, right? To even the old vets, they went back to their origin, because I seen it on Scarface's joints. He's done it as well. He always said, yo, Kendrick is the only dude I'm feeling. Able to revitalize.
Mm-hmm. Revitalize.
Yeah, he was able to. Kendrick was able to revitalize a segment of conscious rap music and even hip hop in general. To now, you see the joints T.I. has been rapping on. We Will Not. These types. This is the energy Kendrick brought in the game. So Drake was and is still to a degree terrified of messing with him in that sense. He can't mess with him lyrically. He would rip him. But the point is, though, his entire career, Drake has had things, there were things that were taken care of for him.
Absolutely.
So you have to ask yourself, what is the entity or who is the group behind Drake that is making sure he remain polished and untouched?
And that's for you guys and ladies to decide.
Okay, so this is your boy Prince.
This is your girl Sincere, and do not forget to donate to our PayPal.
All right, peace.
All through your body, the blow goes like a 12-gauge shot. Feel me? And God said he should send his one begotten son to lead the wild into the ways of the man. Follow me. Eat my flesh, flesh of my flesh. Come with me. Hail Mary, run quick, see what do we have here now? Lord, the God of God. La 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 la. I ain't a killer, but don't push me. Revenge is like the sweetest joy next to getting pussy. Picture paragraphs unloaded, wise words being quoted. Beat the weakness in the rap game and sold it. Down, pray to God, hoping that he's listening. See niggas coming for me, my diamonds when they kiss me. Now pay attention, rest me, please, Father. I'm a ghost, who's killing fields. Hail Mary, catch me if I go deep inside the solitary mind of a man. Screams in the dark, evil lurks, enemies see me flee. Activate my hate, let it break. Trip the prison, selling drugs. We all wrapped up in this living like the studs. To my homeboys and quick max, doing they been. Raise hell to this real shit, and feel this when they turn out the lights. Hell, hell, the dark, the light eternal through my heart. Now, Mary, Mary, nigga, come with me. Hell, Mary, nigga, run quick, see what do we have here now?